A game of chess is like a sword fight. You must think first, before you move.
To be converted, you have to destroy your past, destroy your history. You have to stamp on it. You have to say, my ancestral culture does not exist. It doesn't matter. I need to demonstrate how construction was possible in the 19th century. Otherwise, my future stuff will not make much sense. So there'll be a couple more videos like this coming. I get a lot of comments telling me that it was impossible for those in the 19th century to make so many bricks. So let's have a little look into brick production in the 19th century. I want to read to you excerpts from two sources. The first source is an academic paper on the mechanization of brickmaking in the United States by I.B. Holly. As the article reads, during the early colonial period, houses were often built with bricks that arrived as ballast in English ships, but settlers soon established brickyards to produce bricks locally. Describing an 1810 brickyard in Philadelphia, Holly informs us that it was no more than a few sheds, a locally fabricated kiln, and, of course, a suitable clay bed. Typically, these employed about 30 hands and 6 or 8 boys, who were not apprentices. Rival hand moulders would sometimes hold competitions to see how many bricks they could mould in a 12-hour day. The record appears to have been about 25,000. But of course, the average brickyard worker produced far fewer. 9,000 to 10,000 was considered a fair day's output. There were some 30 brickyards in Greater Philadelphia by 1811. The 1810 census reported a population of 111,000. By 1860, the city had over 565,000 inhabitants. It also had some 50 brickyards, each employing about 30 men and a smattering of boys. I'd like to pause here and have a go at some quick maths. The average brickworker produced between 9 and 10,000 bricks a day. By taking 9,000, we get 45,000 bricks over the course of a 5-day week, even though they probably worked a full week. In 1811, there were 30 brickyards in Greater Philadelphia. 45,000 times 30 makes a regional output of 1,350,000 bricks per week. There are 52 weeks in a year, but brickwork by hand was seasonal. As Holly tells us, in the fall and winter, workers dug raw clay and tossed it into piles. Come spring and summer, they would produce bricks. So let's times 1,350,000 bricks per week by about 20 weeks, just so it's fair. That's 27 million bricks a year. But the plot thickens. In the United States, one David Ridgway filed a patent on a brickmaking machine in 1792, but nothing seems to have come of it. By 1804, 11 patents have been granted on brick machines in the US, and the earliest brickmaking machine for which drawings are known was a horse-powered wooden frame mechanism, which was claimed to produce 30,000 bricks in a 12-hour day. Companies did not jump at the opportunity to use machines, however. The 50 or more Philadelphia brickyards turned out more than 50 million a year during the 1840s, most of them handmade. There was, in fact, a prejudice against machine-made bricks in some quarters. 50 million a year, most by hand. That's a lot of bricks. And you see, they aren't using the machines as an excuse. Let's quickly do the population maths. If each brickworks has about 30 employees, and there were 50 brickworks in Philadelphia by the 1840s, that's a workforce of 1,500 people. The population of Philadelphia in the 1840s was around 94,000. So that's 1.5% of the population. This is just one region in one state. By 1861, brick machines were becoming more and more a success, and companies were using them more and more. J.W. Crary patented a giant machine, probably the largest brick machine ever built, which, the article tells us, was demonstrated in the 1861 Scientific American. I found the journal publication. As it says here, it will, when running quite slow enough, turn out 40,000 bricks per day. Perhaps the most important feature is the manufacture of bricks in all weather. As Holly states, this meant that the machine could be operated in winter as well as summer. So 40,000 bricks a day times a 5-day week times a 52-week year is 10,400,000 bricks a year. Crary was awarded a contract by the federal government to supply 65 million bricks to construct Fort Jefferson. Fort Jefferson was constructed in 31 years, between 1845 and 1876. Crary was contracted in 1861, so that's 15 years. 10,400,000 bricks a year times 15 is 156 million bricks. And construction had already started 16 years before Crary was contracted. The fort is located 68 miles out to sea. But then again, bricks used to arrive to America as ballast in English ships during the early colonial period. This is why academic articles like this are excellent resources for research, because they not only rely and base their findings on primary sources from the 1800s, but they list these sources in footnotes so you can further your research. Some texts found in the footnotes, such as Method of Making Bricks as Followed in Philadelphia, Brick Manufacture and Brick Pavement, A Practical Treatise on the Manufacture of Brick, Tile and Terracotta, 60 Years of Brickmaker, Bricks and Brickmaking Machines. My second source is very different. It's an 1868 travel log detailing an American's travels through the English Midlands and its green borderland. It's not specifically about construction, it's just a travelogue, but as the American is passing through the English Midlands, he encounters many scenes of industry. Let me read you some passages. On the 7th of November, we set out on our walk. Meeting an extensive brickmaker, we stopped to see his establishment. Here, he carrying on a large business in the manufacture of blue-black bricks, of every size and pattern for coping of walls, stable floors and other uses. He had expended £7,000 in buildings and machinery and was turning out about 100,000 bricks a week. The space from which he had taken the clay for 100,000 bricks a week for several years would not measure over half an acre, embracing the whole compass of the pit's mouth. The crater is already 60 feet deep. And the clay, he thinks, will hold good for twice that depth. The steam engine draws up an incline tramway from the bottom of the pit, a huge coal scuttle full of the clay, enough to make 500 bricks, and tips it over at the top of the line into a hopper, whence it goes down through successive kneading troughs, and is at last forced out of an iron cylinder by a piston, all ready to be made into loaves for the oven. The pit he describes here is similar to this one. Its radius is not actually that much, but it goes deep. A steam engine powers the cogs to pull a scuttle full of clay up from the pit, and then the process begins of turning the clay into bricks. Now listen carefully to this. 75% of the persons employed are female, and perhaps two-thirds of these are young girls, from 9 to 12 years of age. Each moulding woman has about two, sometimes three of these girls to serve her, one to bring the clay, the other to carry away the bricks when formed. That's right, women and children. And it's still practiced in some parts of the world today. A woman with her two or three pages will mould 3,000 bricks in a day. The average hours of labour are from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. In all the brick fields, the girls are required to turn on Sunday morning the bricks made on the previous day. It is estimated that upwards of 1,200 females are employed at the various brick fields of the district. So as you just read, Even in 1868, much of the actual brickmaking is done by hand, and machines only aid the process of transporting clay and kneading. Let's do the maths. If it takes one woman and two girls to produce on average 3,000 bricks a day, and there are 1,200 females employed at various brickworks in the region, then we need to divide 1,200 females by 3 to get a figure of 400 teams of females and girls making bricks. 400 teams times 3,000 bricks a day is 1,200,000 bricks a day, and 6 million bricks a week. Let's assume their work is also seasonal, and times 6 million by 26 weeks, or half a year, and that's 156 million bricks a year. And this is just one small region in England. The census of England in 1851 records a population of 16.8 million. And scholar Paul Atterby states that in the same year there was a working population of about 15.7 million. That means that those 1,200 females referenced by this travelogue make up 0.007% of the working population. I do wonder where these females and these children fit into the Tartaria hypothesis, which argues that those in the history books did not and could not have built these structures. And it's an interesting one. Imagine the self-proclaimed truther, always asking questions, generating just enough mystery and intrigue, and yet never actually finding the answers that are sitting right there in the history books and archives. And that reminds me, the Sunnyside Coke Ovens. What Jonathan did not show you are the abundance of photographs in this archive that show what the site looked like before and while in operation. These photographs took me 10 seconds to find on a Google search. The earth above the ovens is hard and baked because they were packed in to generate excessive heat. As you can see, carts ran above these to move the coal. Here is a short clip of another site. These abandoned coke sites are everywhere and well documented. The Sunnyside ovens used to look like this. It's most likely the ovens are all missing their front sections, because a stone was salvaged and reused after decommission in 1958, or to stop squatters from taking residence in them. It happened at the Redstone site. Hippies would squat in these ovens. After they left, residents continued pillaging stone from the ovens. I also noticed that one of the brick manufacturers was Hawes. Hawes makes fire bricks. These are resilient to damage and excessive heat. The first manufacturer, W.H. Hawes Fire Brick Company, built the first refractory plant in America, designed exclusively to make silica brick, or refractories. Silica brick was used to line coke ovens, steel furnaces, steamship and locomotive boilers, and fireboxes of all sorts. Hawes was established in the 19th century. Isn't it more realistic that they just use more resilient bricks here and cheaper ones below? What kind of cataclysm would roast the top and the bottom and leave the middle intact? Also, they actually refurbished 300 coke ovens in 1942 at Sunnyside. Perhaps that's it. This site was decommissioned in 1958. That's only 64 years ago. And here's a shot of them building more ovens. You can see the bricks on the side here. And why didn't you show people these photographs? It's quite easy to generate mystery if you deliberately ignore photographs like this and pretend they don't exist. And here is a quotation to ponder. How do you destroy a people? You take away their culture. And how is that done? You must take their language, their history, their very identity. How would you do that? I pressed my lips together, then looked up at her. You ban their books. Or just ignore them and pretend they don't exist. To be converted, you have to destroy your past. Destroy your history. You have to stamp on it. You have to say, my ancestral culture does not exist. It doesn't matter. Make sure you enjoy the nice weather, keep well, and have a good day.